Tomorrow, fresh from his surprise duet with the Duchess of Cambridge, musician Tom Walker's on Good Morning Britain from 6. From 9 on Lorraine, Joss Stone's inviting us into her kitchen for a warming winter dish. Deborah Meaden's talking great business pitches on This Morning at 10. And Loose Women catch up with Peter Andre at 12:30.
Now, ITV News in the Channel Islands with a special tribute to Gary Burgess.
Good evening and welcome to a very special programme celebrating the life and work of our colleague and friend, Gary Burgess. Gary passed away peacefully at Jersey Hospice on New Year's Day. He was 46. He'd been diagnosed with terminal cancer in 2020 and continued to share his health news as he lived with the disease.
Gary, being Gary, chose not to let ill health stop him from doing what he loved. And it was only in August he stopped appearing on our screens, or as he would put it, retiring enviably young. But that didn't stop him from being involved in our communities or indeed in our lives.
Certainly didn't. Well, this show is an opportunity for us to say goodbye to him and him to you, the viewers. It's also a chance to show how proud we are of such a remarkable man who achieved amazing things both on and off screen. Tributes have flooded in since Gary's death was announced, and tonight we'll give you a flavour of what he meant to the islands and far beyond.
Yes, of course, we know Gary best for his work on our shores, but his career began far away in Blackpool almost three decades ago. And it was clear from the very beginning he was destined to do brilliant things.
Whether he was holding politicians to account or championing one of the many causes close to his heart, one thing was for certain: Gary always put people first. Claire Burton looks back on his career.
Oh, hello. Welcome to the gory fate.
Days were never dull with Gary. For a decade, a friendly face to ITV viewers.
It is a maze, literally made of maze, and anyone who knows what I'm like in the car with my directions will realise this could be a long, late night for me.
Often a comfort to those in need.
Why are you wanting to speak out?
Often uncomfortable for those in power.
This is about fear. This is about worry. This is about a vacuum of speculation and unanswered questions every time the Chief Minister makes a statement.
Gary's first job, though, was in Blackpool at Radio Wave.
It's 24 minutes past eight. This is the Wave Breakfast Show, Blackpool's biggest breakfast show.
Starting as the tea boy, he ended up serving the North West on air.
So thank you for the call this morning. A call from Diane and Steve there in Carlton. Happy 7th anniversary. It's their anniversary today.
He was just a sponge. He would just listen and watch and see what everybody was doing. And he was just, he just had a natural instinct. He just had to be on the radio. He had to be broadcasting.
After honing his skills on the mainland, island life came calling in 2003. Island FM in Guernsey, where he made a huge impression on colleagues and listeners.
I think from the moment that he arrived on the ferry in his, I think it was a Citroen Saxo that he had packed his life in and moved over here when he got the job. And he always said that moment when he got off the boat and saw that beautiful view of St. Peterport Harbour, that he knew he would fit in here. Island life was something that he loved. He loved the community, he loved the warmth about it all. Every single event, all the road shows that we did together, even car boot sales he would go along to just to find out how Guernsey ticked. And I think that was the important thing. When you move over here from the UK, you've got to know how the island works, and he threw himself into that.
And when it came to understanding how Guernsey politics worked, he was as forensic as he was friendly.
He had a most beguiling style as a journalist, which was because everybody found him so easy to get along with. It was easy to fall into a trap of thinking that perhaps you might get an easier ride. But, of course, that was never the case.
Gary's love affair with radio was put on hold in 2011 when he landed a job at Channel Television.
Guernsey's Social Security Department says 27 widows were affected by the changes when the pension was scrapped back in 2004.
A year later, he moved from his beloved Guernsey to be one of Channel's chief reporters in Jersey.
A day of drama, a day of chaos, a day of fears of a major explosion in the heart of St. Helier.
Gary's inquisitive, challenging interviews and friendly, natural style helped him cover the most sensitive of subjects. In the aftermath of Jersey's care inquiry, it was Gary that abuse survivors came to tell their stories.
The dark secrets hidden behind the doors of care and foster homes in Jersey are about to have light shed on them. The victims' voices finally heard.
He asked very direct questions, not in an insensitive way, but direct, so that enabled the interviewee to get over what needed to be said. Had it not been for Gary's work, then I would question whether progress would have been made with some aspects of the care inquiry's recommendations. His work was invaluable.
Giving a voice to the marginalised became his purpose, championing many causes for equality and diversity.
He was a compassionate man, and I think, you know, he could empathise with people whose stories were not always heard. There are issues that you may not come across in your everyday life, but they are coming across on a daily basis. Unless you have a journalist who's prepared to say that, then we're not going to get anything changed for those people.
And he occasionally put himself at the heart of a story with the fight for equal marriage legislation.
We're finally husband and husband. As much as our wedding day was back in March, and we always knew and thought like that, to actually have that legally said, you know, rubber stamped as it were, it's a really nice feeling.
To have somebody who was working in media who had that personal experience and it mattered really personally to them was hugely important. Gary's contribution in that really can't be underestimated. There were a few people that I can pinpoint that were, you know, pivotal in turning the tide of opinion, and Gary was one of them.
But some of the cuts are not quite what you might think of as cuts.
He never took his eye off the government, though, and when the most powerful man in Jersey, top civil servant Charlie Parker, was found to have taken on a lucrative second job, Gary probed the process and the probity. Mr. Parker eventually resigned. But perhaps the defining period of Gary's career came in the early days of the coronavirus pandemic.
A private and confidential letter to the chief minister. They say, "We find this lack of urgency from our elected leaders utterly ridiculous and infuriating."
Despite recovering from gruelling chemotherapy treatment, Gary worked tirelessly to keep the public informed and the politicians accountable.
"I just wonder, have you said enough?"
Those caring for vulnerable elderly islanders were grateful.
"Those days were really, really dark, really scary, and nobody really understood what the care sector did. So all of a sudden, people needing to use PPE, there was a scramble for it, and it was being kind of held back for the hospital in the event that the hospital would have a surge. We actually needed it in the community to protect our most vulnerable. So having somebody like Gary, who was willing to literally poke the bear that didn't want to be poked and get an answer was really phenomenal."
A body of work that saw him presented last year with the bailiff's silver seal.
"It became entirely clear that he was holding a unique position and a position of enormous trust from islanders, I think, who relied on him to report in the way he did. And as my knowledge of him grew, it became entirely clear that we should recognise it in some way. The best way to do that was the silver seal, which is very rare, hardly ever presented. I haven't done one before and haven't done one since."
And in more relaxed surroundings, the awards kept on coming. The island's community champion, which people who knew Gary best said summed up the man and his mission.
"Gary wasn't just a journalist, he wasn't just a broadcaster. Gary wanted to help people. You see, Gary grew up in South Africa, so he saw a great deal of inequality in society. And he knew at 7 or 8 that it was wrong, but he couldn't challenge it. But later on, as a journalist, he could challenge things. So if somebody said, 'Oh, well, that's just the way it is,' if any politician said to him, 'Well, that's just what's happening,' that's where he would challenge it, and he would stand up for people. The public thought he was on their side. And just towards the end, the only question he kept asking me was, 'Did I do enough? You know, have I done enough in life?' And I think he did. I think he did more than enough. We miss him terribly."
"We all love you so much, Gary."
"I just want to thank you for supporting me over the past decade. It has meant the world to me. every single day, and I really am going to miss you. You take care.
Yes, Gary there speaking on the day he retired.
And while it was work that brought Gary to the Channel Islands, they would go on to capture his heart and become his home. It was here where he married his beloved husband, Alan, and where he lived out his final days. Even while strapped to an oxygen machine, you couldn't stop him from visiting his favourite spots in Jersey. Our thoughts, of course, continue to be with Gary's loved ones, particularly Alan and Gary's family during this difficult time. So we'd like to take this opportunity to remind you of Alan's beautiful tribute to his husband.
Yes, Alan said, "Thank you to the many well-wishers who have sent us their love and kind words." Gary was always grateful for the many kindnesses he was shown. I expect there'll be many tributes made to Gary, and I want to keep my words about him now as simple as I can. To misquote a line of dialogue from the final episode of The West Wing, one of Gary's favourite programmes, and something said with love and pride by one spouse to the other, "You did a lot of good, Gary, a lot of good."
He certainly did, and you can read all of Alan's words in full on our website, itv.com/channel.
We've heard what a difference Gary's reporting made, but he was equally proud, as are we, of the work he did for charity, both in public and private as well. He campaigned tirelessly to raise money and awareness for cancer and the illness ME.
And when our communities raised thousands of pounds to give Gary and Alan a dream holiday, they decided to donate it all to charity instead. His legacy will continue to live on in the hundreds of people he helped along the way. My report begins with one of Gary's campaigns, delivered in Gary's unique, cheeky style.
Hello, I'm Gary, and these are my balls, something you should never be embarrassed to talk about.
Shameless in using shock tactics, relentless in raising awareness. Gary used his public image to help many campaigns, and this one for male cancers was close to his heart as he was diagnosed at just 23.
I was watching daytime TV and they'd done what at the time was groundbreaking, a testicular examination. And that night I was in bed and thought, I should try it myself. And the very first time I checked my balls, I found a lump.
It just took the charity to a completely new level. The feedback we had from the GPs and the MSG locally was that referrals were about double for that period of in the year coming, which was just kind of completely and utterly unheard of. And that's kind of some kind of legacy we leave, I guess, in terms of literally save people's lives. It's which is amazing.
And Gary's involvement did make a difference.
100. He was the figurehead for the whole thing.
Gary hasn't just supported charity campaigns, he's inspired some too. Jumping in puddles was the idea of Gary's friend Susie after he told her his cancer was terminal.
I came across this poster and it said, when life gives you rain, go jump in a puddle. And I was like, you know what, that is absolutely Gary. Let's send him some welly boots and let's get him jumping in a puddle.
That inspired hundreds of others to do the same, and it's raised more than £50,000 for Cancer Research UK.
We're going to reach 1 million. That's my promise to Gary. And in my opinion, that's his legacy, born from our friendship.
And it was our friendship that led to another legacy.
Are there some specific things you want to achieve or experience in the next 6 to 12 months?
We want to go on one last cruise together. We love being on cruise ships for our holidays.
When viewers saw our emotional conversation, they set up a Just Giving page to make that dream come true. Wow. More than £32,000 was raised for Gary and his husband, Alan. But Gary gave it all to Macmillan Jersey, plugging a shortfall in their rent during COVID. And to say thank you, they've named a room after him.
The little plaque up there is a really lovely sort of lasting legacy that will go with us, wherever we go. So at the moment we're here at the Oasis, and wherever our new home for cancer support will be, that plaque will be coming with us and his legacy will live on. So we're really grateful that we can recognise the impact that he's had as a person for so many people affected by cancer.
But it's not just people affected by cancer he's helped.
Having a tougher day today. I got up this morning, I went for a little walk, and I'm just absolutely beaten up.
In 2017, Gary went public about having ME, a condition that causes extreme tiredness, pain, and impaired thinking. He created video diaries to educate the public. And fellow sufferers like Chrissy say having a well-known face demystify the illness was invaluable.
It helped a lot because he had a lot of similar traits to what I had. And then I think other people were sort of saying, oh, will I get this? Is that normal? So, there's so many different symptoms of having ME.
And as well as raising awareness, Gary was passionate about raising money. When he fronted a wristband campaign for cancer research, they sold out in all the shops in Jersey.
Gary's left an enormous legacy, not only in the money that he's helped raise for Jumping in Puddles, but the work he did for World Cancer Day, in sharing his story and inspiring other people to donate money in the future. He was a joy to work with, a complete professional. He was cheerful. He was just one of the really good guys. And I think that legacy is going to live on.
Gary was a giant amongst men. He's the way he took the diagnosis, not only the first one but the second one, the integrity and everything he stood for. It's just incredible. He absolutely fought like a warrior, and his legacy is guaranteed as far as we're concerned.
Yeah, such important work there with charity. Well, such was Gary's huge character on the telly here at Channel that you probably feel you knew him, even if you hadn't been one of those lucky enough to grab a few words with him when he was out and about. And he did love to chat, of course, didn't he? Well, you may have even been the inspiration for his next story.
Yes, as a team here at Channel, we were lucky to get to know the man behind the scenes, a brilliant journalist, always full of ideas and passion. Here are a few of our memories.
When it came to the States, Gary just knew everything and everyone. You really couldn't keep up with him. And he made it look really kind of off the cuff and cheeky and funny. What you didn't see was he would read those like boring 500-page reports and find the nugget at the end that the government didn't want you to find. He'd spend his days off going for coffees with contacts to get the real gossip. And it's that kind of graft that you don't necessarily see, but we saw, and it was just really inspirational.
He was the first person I told that I was having a baby, aside from my husband, because he's so intuitive, he knows you so well. And we've been out for a coffee and I said, oh, I'll have a decaf this time. And he just looked me straight in the eyes and said, you're pregnant, aren't you? And he didn't even know we were trying.
Gary would always make sure his story was either the very top story, it's very important, or it's the last story and we're just having the best time. We're having a laugh with it.
He could just pick up the slightest thing that happened in the background and make the most of it. Any unusual circumstances, he thrived on that. And he just loved having someone else to bounce ideas off as well. But he was also an incredibly capable person to be able to just present on his own and make the most of the situation.
A couple of years ago, I went to SARC with Gary, and we were sent over to do three stories, and it was education, chief police, and I think it was SARC docs guys. But we were there for 24 hours, and Gary was thinking, yep, no, we can do more than that. And we came back with something like 18 elements for other stories. And Gary was that sort of person that if you sent him out for one story, he'd always try and come back with at least two more.
If Gary was waiting to go live, the technical team would ask for him to say something to test his microphone was working. And he would say this silly little rhyme, I'm a little teapot, short and stout. Here's my handle, here's my spout, tip me up. And news pours out, and it just kind of summed him up in so many ways and made us all laugh.
And you get to see that real rendition of that later in the programme, so stay tuned.
Yeah, brilliant. Well, we were lucky enough to have had a decade worth of Gary here at Channel.
Yes, and from his very first day, it was always clear he was going to be one of the biggest stars in our team. Our head of news, Karen Rankin, is the woman who's responsible for putting him on the box for ITV.
Well, I sat down with her earlier to talk about how it all began.
I remember when I first met Gary, and it was when he came for interview. And he walked into the room, and one of the questions we always ask is, you know, have you watched the programme? What do you think of the programme? And is there anything we could do better? Gary launched into a fantastic critique of the programme, and honestly, a seasoned programme editor could not have got it more right. And I just sat back and I thought, goodness, we've got such a talent here.
So we talked about Gary there being such a huge part of the team and loving the team as well. Loving the team, loving life, loving laughs.
Oh, absolutely. Gary made us laugh every single day. It didn't matter how stressed we were in the newsroom, Gary would waltz in and within a few minutes everyone would be laughing and the tension would be lifted.
And if there was one abiding memory of Gary, what would that be?
Gary often used to say to me that he felt really lucky, that he couldn't believe that he'd been ever allowed on the telly, and it used to make me laugh. But in truth, I think we were the lucky ones. We were lucky to have been able to give that talent a chance to shine. And we were lucky just to have him as part of the Channel team.
We certainly were, and some more wonderful reflections there on Gary's time here at Channel. And speaking of tributes, if you'd like to write one of your own for Gary, you can. We've opened a book of condolence online for him. The details how to do that are also on our website, itv.com/channel. We've also put some information there about help and support that's available if you're affected by this evening's programme.
So what's left to say? You've heard many tributes tonight remembering Gary from the telly, but tonight I'd just like to take a moment to remember Gary, my friend.
You see, the things that made Gary a great broadcaster also made him a great buddy. His passion for people, his love of life, his amazing mind and desire to debate made him the most captivating company. But what I really loved about Gary was how he just lit up my life with laughter. That razor-sharp wit and endless innuendos would have me proper belly laughing. And while we laughed a lot, we cried a lot too. And that was the real magic in our friendship, that I had the privilege of seeing past the showman you all love and got to know a vulnerable soul. So to Gary, thank you for being my clown, my confidant and my inspiration. I'm forever grateful to have had you in my life.
Brilliantly put, Jess. Really brilliantly put. Now, it wouldn't be a programme about Gary if he didn't get to do the and finally section of the show. They are, after all, the most fun bits and the ones that we all love.
Yep, Gary was always up for a laugh and never afraid to be the butt of the joke. All in the name, of course, of good telly. And with his infectious sense of humour, we know he would want you to smile at some of his best bits.
Half an hour into my first lesson. I'm not great, but my word, I'm loving it.
Gary was never afraid to pull his weight when it came to the and finally section of the programme. He leapt at the chance to show off his physical prowess, or lack of it.
I'm doing my best. I've had a go at paddleboarding, and I've got a very wet bottom.
We knew Gary had many talents, and over the years, he's shared a few of them with us. As well as a few choice outfits.
My arms are blue, my legs are blue. Trust me when I tell you, even my underwear is blue.
Am I okay to go then?
And he put himself ever so slightly out of his comfort zone every now and then.
And I think, Wilsey and Dunny, that I gave a good, calm, considered account of myself. Gary Burgess, ITV News, still alive.
Oh, Gary, they say you're a drama queen. I don't know what they're talking about.
No.
Being one of the most recognisable faces in the Channel Islands sometimes proved a challenge.
That's not right. How are you? Thank you.
But Gary only rarely shied away from being on camera.
Oh, I don't like this. No. Go away. So whatever you
do. And if there's one thing that Gary wanted all of us at Channel to know, it's that...
I'm a little teapot short and stout. Here's my inquiry, here's my pen. Hello, I'm still a little journalist. I'm still short and stout. Here's my handle and here's my spout. Tip me up and my news pours out.
Well, do you know what? I was going to get my application in, but you just don't want to upstage these contestants, do you? Yes, they've got their six-packs, but I've got my beer barrel belly.
Gary so obviously loved his job as much as he loved life.
As for me, living my best life, a career high with my milk bottle legs out on a beach in the dark. Meanwhile, you two are living the life of Riley in a nice warm studio. Cheers.
The news really did pour out absolutely wonderful, quite delightful. Well, it's almost time for us to say goodbye, but the person who most wanted the final word, well, as ever, you can probably guess, it was Gary himself,
couldn't
wasn't it?
Stop him.
No.
Ever the workaholic, and it has to be said, control freak. He wasn't
yeah, okay.
a control freak. It should come as no surprise that Gary worked with us to put this programme together. He never wanted to be left out, and we hope we've done him proud.
But we know Gary was as much a member of our family here at Channel as he was yours, be that watching him on screen, listening to him on the radio, or reading his words in the local paper. So from us, it's good night. We'll leave you once more with Gary.
What have I learned in these dying weeks of my life? Well, actually, I've learned that I'm possibly the luckiest man in the world to have friends and family around me, my husband, Alan, and so many people I don't know who've got in touch to offer their support to me. It's that reminder of community, that reminder of the goodness of the human spirit. But beyond that, I've also realised I've lived my life in fast forward. It's only in recent weeks that I've properly slowed down. And when you slow down, you notice so much more. I've noticed the bees going from one petal to another on a flower until they found the perfect one. I've noticed more butterflies than ever before. Now, it can't be that there are more bees and butterflies doing the rounds. It's just that I never stop to take notice. My mantra in recent weeks, and one I offer to you, is take twice as long to do half as much. And remember that goodness of the human spirit. If you can offer a random act of kindness today, that might just mean the world of difference to a stranger. For now, though, it's time for me to say goodbye. Thank you. It's been a pleasure and it's been a privilege to talk to you like this. Goodbye. That'll do. Cheers, mate. That was a one-take wonder.
The teachers immediately moved all the pupils onto the playing fields for their safety.
I see trees of green, red roses.
I'm in the market for love.
I see them.
No,
blue.
I'm actually in the market for love.
For me and you.
Guernsey crafts on display, and my goodness, give you a twirl.
What a wonderful world.
Oh my God.
I see skies of blue.
A grave political error. You yesterday used those words and tweaked them.
Is that God?
Blessed
day. Oh my word.
The dark sacred night. I think to myself, what a wonderful